Getting my sound hooked up here. Looks like the sound flower is sound flowering. And my audio is auditing, audioing. And since it's Tuesday night, once again, we're gathered here, those who are brave enough to be in the Keshe Plasma Reactor Group for 3 years going, and we've never been censored so far. Well, maybe once or twice to take things down. But generally speaking, we've been free going for that time period and tend to keep going forever. So, as you can see here, once again, our star to start off the group tonight. My name's Rick Graham, by the way, your host, and this is the Keshe Plasma Reactor Group. And we have Lee Coates here. He's got yet another rotating device, and we always like to see rotating devices here, which spinning things are one of my hang-ups, you might say. So feed me, Lee. Tell me what this is all about here. You've got, it seems to be a globe, but is it got liquid in it or air? It's hard to tell.
Yeah, this is I showed this to you last week as a work in progress, and I just finished it off yesterday. So what we've got is a motor spinning a drinking glass, which I bought at the dollar store. Yeah, they actually got four different sizes of glasses like this at the dollar store. And then I glued a piece of glass on the top to seal off the top with some green goop. And I got another motor on top, which spins a shaft and spins a set of coils in the middle. Now, right now, all I've got is 20 milliliters of lead Gantz water and 60 milliliters of CH3 Gantz water in there. So there's not very, that's like less than a quarter of the glass full. So there's not much liquid in there right now. It's all plastered all around the sides as it spins. And
That would be air in the middle where the coils are then?
yes, the coils
Or
are totally in the air.
colored air, anyways. Yes.
That little band, you dark band you see in the middle there, I think
Yeah.
it's CO2 Gantz has come off the coils and has migrated to the center there,
Okay.
because those coils had a CO2 Gantz and the, not CO2, C, yeah, CuO2 copper Gantz on it, and it was fairly heavy, and so the Gantz powder was coming off.
Right, and you used just the Gans water with the other Ganses that you added. There was no Gans per se in the Gans water.
No, it's just the water,
I
lead
see.
Gantz water and CH3 Gantz water.
Well, that's something to think about, that whatever gets put on the coils has a chance of exiting the coils and becoming part of the outside structure. So in terms of either contamination or maybe stuff that you want to have thrown out to the outside, it's
Yeah, well,
kind of a
when
feature
I
or a
Gantz
bug,
those
depending.
coils, that was 3 months ago, and I was using too thick a solution, so it was on there pretty thick. That's why it's coming
They
off.
talk about some people use just the Gans water now, so that would be more compatible, I guess.
Yeah, so anyway, I
Yep.
haven't well, actually, when you put your hand around on the side of it, you sort of detect something. There might be a field there.
Yeah, well, you'll get some wind blowing from it anyway, just from
Yeah, if you
the,
get close, you get the wind blowing, but
yeah. And
and
there
I
will
had
be definitely electrostatic type effects, which is a field, and I think that's a field that's intimately connected with the type of fields we need to be looking at.
then I made this little guy here today. I one of the I got on the private trainings with Keshi there, so I'm one of the trainings they were talking about making a ball with sort of coils around it. The idea was it would spin or something. This one doesn't spin at all, and I thought, well, maybe I'll put it beside this thing, hang it there, and see if it'll do anything to detect the fields. I thought maybe I could invent a field detector, but no, it's
Well,
not. Doesn't do it. Just hangs there and doesn't do anything, so.
Well, tell us now, each coil is you've got a double coil in each one of those coils, I guess, right?
That's correct.
And are they the input or the ingoing and outgoing fields are connected on each coil, like the
Yeah,
input and output?
the here gravitational is just gravitational to gravitational connected, and the outside magnetic coils there, magnetic to magnetic.
Okay.
And there's
So each layer is a separate layer. They're not interconnected.
That's correct.
Right. So
So I would
that's
think that you would want go from gravitational from the bottom up to the magnetical at the top, and then back down through the center of the ball, make it a homogeneous system.
not what I understood from the training, but maybe I should listen to it again and.
Yeah, I understood that they should be separate in this particular example. I had a diagram that looked almost exactly like that, with a football shape, but individual coils that weren't connected with each other. I asked Mr. Keshe whether the coils would be connected to each other than from the fields, and he said just to connect the input to the output, basically. So.
Yeah, it just strikes me as you're reproducing the planet, and you would want that constant flow. But I wasn't on the training, so I don't know the details about it. It strikes me as that you would want that it to be a homogeneous system rather than six separate.
Yeah. Well, anyway, that's the first try, and doesn't seem to be doing anything, so I can always rewire it here and try again.
Yeah, it's this type of configuration that actually might take time to build up as well. It's the type of thing that contains, if you were a I don't know, some sort of anti-proton plasma or something in the middle of that structure, then it would tend to contain that plasma because it's built such that it would vibrate back and forth without exiting, and each ring contains the field, and each one has its purpose, you might say, or core strength. That the small ones at each end prevent or focus the plasma. So, like for example, if you look at the three bottom rings of your structure there, from the middle one and then the center one and the bottom. Oh, okay, there's four there.
There's one more on the bottom.
Five. I missed that one, the little guy, holy cow. So what he was talking about is that creates a plasma drill effect. It would be like a tapered pointy thing. So in other words, it would, when you have a taper like that at a certain angle, taper, the ions can't escape. The ions of a plasma can't escape. They just bounce around and go back the other way. That's why the football shape is so important. That's why Tesla's football shape coil was perhaps the most important coil he ever made. He said it had anti-gravity, or someone said it had anti-gravity properties with his football-shaped coil. So it's essentially what you have there is a similar type arrangement, and who knows what magical properties it could have.
Yeah, mine's not football shaped. It's actually made a couple of circles intersecting there in the middle. So maybe I should redo the center in the football shape.
Well, yeah, it's more of a soccer ball than a football, but it has the taper. That's the idea. It tapers down at each end to the smaller sort of pointy thing, as opposed to an open design, which would have a different effect. So it contains the central plasma that way, and something in the middle, perhaps the free plasma, should be contained in that structure. But the thing is, it may have to be stimulated in some way, or in the correct environment. It may take time to build up, and there's different factors involved.
Yeah, and I didn't nano coat the plastic inside there either, so that's might be a problem.
being surrounded by all those coils, it may have no other option than to nanocoat itself at this point. You know, spray a little cold weak caustic on the whole structure. Sometimes people do that as well to kind of nanocoat it.
Could do that. Anyway, I got one other thing to show you. I was trying to make more pure CO2 Gantz, and what I got was this beige stuff out of the pot, and I didn't have a clue what it was. And then on Golden Age of Gantz today, I noticed someone else came up with a beige Gantz that they said was pure CO2 Gantz.
I read that, yeah. And so this is a big topic, actually. I was going to bring this up later. So, you know, how do we create the ultimate clean, purest possible CO2 GANS and not have the zinc oxide and other things, involved with it? So, yeah, tell us about that then.
This is the Gantz factory over here.
That's me.
All my different Gantz pots.
Great.
Anyway, this one here was the one I was trying to make pure CO2 Gantz from. I had zinc plates all around the outside, which were wrapped in Saran wrap or Handy wrap, and then on the inside I got the scrubby pads tied in a circle. And for the first 3 weeks, I did nothing. It wasn't producing anything. And then I started getting some of this beige Gantz, which I didn't know what it was, because I thought pure CO2 Gantz was white.
So it depends on the conditions that you're making it in. I've had white. I've had kind of an off-white. I've had a very, very light baby blue. Because of the cellophane that your zinc is wrapped in, with cellophane is made from wood. So you're going to have some component of that wood in there. That may be where your beige is coming from. Now that's not going to be, I can't say that it would be a non pure CO2, because we've already been told that the CO2 GANS can come out several different colors depending upon the conditions that you make it in. So I wouldn't discount that you don't have good CO2 at this time.
Okay. Well, there's no way to test it to know what it is. So really, but.
Yeah. I mean, my CO2 collector right now, the zinc strip is simply wrapped around the outside of the container. And I've got a nano coated copper coil hanging down into the center of the brine. And it, like you said, for a couple of weeks, it just sat there and did nothing. And now I'm collecting a kind of a really light baby blue, very fluffy looking Gantz. And it looks like the CO2. It looks like the top of a cloud, where it's very, very fluffy. It's not like zinc, which is like toothpaste, but it's a very fluffy type of Gantz, which I'm pretty certain that it's CO2. And I mean, the baby blue stuff, I'm putting it in my water and I've got it on my health pads, and it works. It works just fine.
Hello, everybody.
Hi, Mario.
No, this is Mark. This is Mark from Detroit.
Oh.
Hi. I had one question that I'm glad everybody's talking about the way we make our Gantz right now, because this is what I'm really thinking about. Have been thinking about. Lee, have you been making Gantz for a long time, and I've taken a lot of hints from you. Have you ever tested the pH in the water?
No, I never have.
Has anybody ever tested the pH in the water? In any of their Gantz waters? And anybody ever stuck a digital pH meter in any or all their Gantz waters? Or because
I recently got a meter and started playing around with it a bit, but I haven't made a study of that. And that's something that's actually pretty critical. Yes, that's right.
Right. because I've, like I said, Rick, I started over all over again, and it really made me. I'm not a critical thinker, but it, since I've restarted doing every, it's made me think so much at how we should be doing it, or, and I have so many questions, and I don't mean to take up a lot of people's time, and I'm so excited that I couldn't wait.
No, this is not taking up time. This is the kind of thing that we need to address, and if it's easy questions, then we can answer them easily, and if they're penetrating questions that require a lot of thought, then we can ponder them, and everybody can add things to them, and so on. It's the simplest thing, like, this is the very basic thing that Kesh showed us years ago, and he showed us in the books from, what, 10 years ago or something. And here we are trying to recreate the best CO2 GANS still. And it's an important thing. It's so many subtle little things that affect, you know, the conditions, like John was saying, the conditions change what the product is that you're getting, and how do we measure it? We don't have accurate ways of saying, you know, this is, you know, 92.5% CO2 GANS and 8% something else and so on. We still have to develop ways other than visual, which is we look at texture and we look at color, basically, or how it responds in our distilled water. I call it texture. It's like the consistency, you might say.
Yeah, Vivek and I have discovered by doing this on opposite ends of the world that the salt concentration is going to change depending upon where you're at. If I use Vivek's salt concentration, I get nothing. If he uses mine, he gets nothing. Hmm. And, I'm in around 8 to 10%. I think Vivek is closer to 20%.
Hmm. Yes.
And it's still distilled water.
Yes. Yeah.
And someone a point came up the other day, which I had to ponder a bit, which is, what is it we need out of the salt solution? And it's primarily the sodium chloride, the NaCl. And there's some thought, why not use just pure NaCl and not sea salt, which has so many other derivatives in it that would lend to different textures and different colors and so on, different elements that get involved in the reaction that's taking place. So that's something to ponder as well. Maybe it's responding mostly to the NaCl percent in the salt itself, as opposed to other...
I haven't done enough to actually definitively say it, but my findings so far, when I use the pink, the gray sea salt, or the plain regular white iodized SIFTO table salt, I was getting white or kind of off-white, sort of grayish GANS, CO2 GANS. When I use the pickling salt, the coarse pickling salt, which is just NaCl, that's when it came out the powder blue. Now, whether or not that's what caused it, I can't say, but I did have a different result depending upon the salt that I used.
Hello, Rick. Hello, John. Hello, Mark. This is Sylvester. What Mark pointed out about the pH, I think also would be a very important things to basically follow up and do. Someone should do a separate test on it. Here in Asia, in South Korea and Japan, we have machines that can produce constant pH water. You can set the machines up to 7, 7.5, 8, 8.5, 10, even 10.5 pH. They working with electrolysis invented by the Russians. Basically, a machine is breaking down the water to pH and acidic water.
And yeah, I've heard they've had them in the hospitals in Japan for like 20 years or something.
They actually very, very successfully curing, you know, all sorts of problems, because many studies shows that the cell itself is in a pH state, cancers and other, you know, these formations, which basically a type of formation, the reaction of the body, they kind of form on pH environment. So, you know, I drinking myself different waters, we cooking with this water, and I noticed that I was also very interested of gastronomy, and I love teas and I love coffees. So if you have a constant quality water, purified water, from the same type of filtering system. If you drink exactly the same tea, for example, if you bring in your own tea into a different tea shops, your own tea gonna taste totally different in every tea shops when you go, just because they use a different, you know, water, different purified or non-purified water. So that makes sense, what you're saying, you know, the water, what people use, the pH is important. Another thing what I wanted to discuss and bring it up maybe to what you guys think is there's a Hungarian fellow playing with CO2 gas putting into the water. You know, the carbon water, which you guys are drinking when you go to the restaurants, still water or carbonized water?
Yes, yeah, I've been looking at those units with lab lust in my eyes recently. Yep.
Yeah, when you add carbon dioxide to the water, you're creating carbonic acid, and it's gonna throw your pH way low.
Yeah. It's definitely helped the production. This guy from Hungary, what he played is a young guy, follower of cash technology. He played this type of GANS productions into a glass environment, and he placed his plates in it as this had to. And he also using these vaporizer from aquariums, when you put it in and there's a little special stone inside, yes, exactly the same. And he not use ozone air or normal air. What he does, he use this special gas of carbon.
Yeah, when you use the fish tank bubbler,
exactly,
it breaks up the amino acid on the top layer too, that lets
And this can speed up the oxidization itself, but over there, you know, he's basically pumping an extra carbon inside. So I wanted to know, I mean, John slightly mentioned that what's the reaction is pH going to be, you know, changed immediately. But anyone else, they try to use that technique? Basically, it can speed up the production if it's set up in a...
I have my microphone. So let me repeat that. Some people use an air bubbler and just bubbled into this the GANS solutions in order to usually to oxidize the GANS more, or sometimes the nanoparticles too.
Yeah, yes. There was a couple of people on the Facebook group some time ago that were talking about, well, why not use like club soda instead of water? That it came up. And it just evaporated. Nobody, it didn't go anywhere. So I don't know if anybody is actually doing that at all.
Hello, but
I was thinking, if we're using distilled water to start with, the potential hydrogen should be relatively stable. It should be as close to 7 as possible. So if there is a swing, it's going to be from any adjunct you add to it, whether it's in your salt, residue in your bucket. If there's something, you know, an oil that's coming out of your pump, rubber bits, anything like that. I don't think that distilled water in Taiwan is going to be any different than distilled water in North America.
In distilled water, only the pH is going to be, you know, a little bit different. There are some places when you can got, 7, 7.5, and some places you even go with 9, 9.2, 9.5.
Yeah, but don't you think pH is going to be changed everywhere in every different condition? That's why I think that it's so important. You know, people that live in mountains have higher, in the altitude, it's higher. John's got a bigger container, which allows, you know, or Lee right there has got a bigger container. The pH is going to change everywhere. So, the thing that I just wanted to get back to was the pH is a stable environment. We were all born, or our life environment is in a pH where we live right now. We're the oxygen and everything is in a certain level where we live. We have to, if we were too acidic, we'd melt down. If we were too alkalitic, that wouldn't work either. We found a nice basic, you know, that's
like
is it a standard?
Our blood, for example, has to be within a very, very narrow spread within point something, 7.3 something, you know, pH, or they call us dead, basically.
Goodbye. So that would be called a standard, right?
The average or standard, they have very specific.
It would give us something to start range. From. That's why I'm trying to figure out, because this all has to start from the liquid that we put in, the plates that we put in, the air that we add to it, the salt, and the caustic. And this is where it's really messing me up right now. And that's what I'm trying to figure out. Using my brain power the hardest is because, let me ask everybody this right now. When anybody that nano coats their plates that are making GANS, when we nano coat it, I use the steam, you know, I use a cooler, and I, you know, use the caustic material where you put the hot water in and it boils and it makes the steam, and you know, and I keep it in a nice cooler, and the plates got really nice and dark and everything, and I, you know, discharged them and everything like we're supposed to do, but I never rinsed them. They had the caustic on them the entire time. I keep doing it, and you know, I do it three or four, I probably nano coated and discharged maybe five or six times for my plates. And I was making nice GANS with it. But in my thinking now is the caustic is still on the plate. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, definitely it will still be on the plate.
You so can that see would be on every white plate, right? That's making sometimes. This, right?
Well, you're supposed to wash the plate is the idea, and dry them either coat them or get them into the experiment right away before they start turning green and whatnot.
Yeah, by mentioning coating it, I saw a gentleman who dipped the nano-coated plate into beeswax and created a type of, you know, protections of the plate. And for after a long, long, long time, the plate was untouched.
Yeah, he wondered if he was creating beeswax GANS.
Yeah, before some people that just started to using silicone, and that is more contaminations into the environment. But beeswax itself is a nano state, so it's a very natural nano material.
Interesting.
Yeah, I've used silicone shoe spray, and I've had really good results with that.
Is that right? And the other one is, what about the coconut oil? Some people coat with the coconut oil. It leaves a beautiful finish and so on. Does it come off or does it interfere with the process?
Yeah, so far what I see is these beeswax coating or filming that gives a good result.
How do you put it on thin? Would you have to heat
up the plate? You're heating up a little bit of the wax, and you know, you just dip it in.
Has and anybody?
Oh, you can have a little brush, or you can have some other way of putting the hot wax on the surface. But you don't need to put too much. You know, just a small amount, basically creating a small film on it.
Maybe we need spray on beeswax.
Go
ahead, Mario. I think you've been trying to get in there patiently for the last few minutes. Sorry to.
Yeah, no, it's okay. I'm kind of cutting in here. Hello, everybody. Has anybody tried to use GANS to set the pH of the still water? In other words, you can use the CO2 GANS, even probably mix a little of the water of the GANS, or put a copper coil underneath the container that it'll settle all, it'll change the, it should balance the pH, shouldn't it? That's what the Philippine guys were talking about, right?
And yes. But what if you're trying to create the GANS to start with and your pH is off, you'd have to
assume you already have some GANS to use to set the pH for your distilled water, then anywhere you are in the world, you'll always be able to get a standard. And it should be at equal balance for the human body as far as it look like. And the same thing with when you get your GANS, you're going to get contamination from the caustic. I think it's impossible to get all of the caustic off, but the CO2, it should neutralize anything. It should separate it. In other words, like I had some caustic, I tried it. The caustic water I had, it's like blue water, and I put an anechoic plate in a piece of plastic and put it in there, and it separated the water. You know, I got that from the guys last week in the workshop, you know? In other words, you can get the pure GANS by using you can balance the pH by using the GANS. You can clear out the contamination if you have it. Should be able to do that using the GANS. But something I really wanted to ask you guys about, did you notice was it last week, Mr. Keshe was saying he was talking about nano coating and getting GANS at the same time, I think, where he said, instead of using the caustic, you use salt water. And I'm not sure about if it's clear on this, but he was saying you use the electrolysis, you put in a certain voltage, and you nano coat that way with using salt water and the voltage, and you put another plate in there, and it doesn't matter what plate you have, using alterations of the electric current, the voltage and the amps and such, you can get any GANS you want.
I thought it was the other way around. He was talking about using caustic and putting current in it.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Mario. He was talking about that, and that's where I was trying to go towards.
Well, but he said instead of the CONH, you can use salt.
Well, we already start with the salt.
Yeah, but he was saying to nano coat and create your GANS at the same time. So that as you're nano coating, you're releasing the energy directly into the salt water. And no matter what kind of plate you get, by altering that, you can get any GANS you want.
That's what I got. And this is what I'm thinking. And it just let me think. My heart.
No caustic at all. Just salt.
You control the caustic, because if you just made like a little bottle of caustic, you know, a dripper, 10, 12 ounces of caustic, and you controlled it, because caustic, you can control the caustic with the pH by adding it to the salt. So if you did that and you had two copper plates, and you had just two copper plates in the salt, the salt was starting to do its thing. Now all of a sudden you introduced the caustic into that solution of the two plates and the salt. One of them's going to start giving and one's going to start taking, right? Is that the thing, right?
I think Mr. Keshe said, I saw it a couple of times, but I could get it wrong because it's always, you know how it is.
Yes.
100 times, but I'm pretty sure he clearly said crossed off the NaOH and put on the Cl whatever salt instead of caustic, using salt.
Salt with just two plates.
Yeah, salt water and two plates and electrolysis.
What do you think about this, Rick?
Yeah, I'm kind of interested. Did you get that?
To me, it was the other way around, that we've already done electrolysis with plates and so on. That's been done for a long time. But I thought he introduced the idea, and that was with salt water primarily. You can use different plates and, you know, add a bit of power, create different substances, or depending, just accelerate the process to get the GANSes. But he seemed to introduce the idea of putting power into a caustic solution with plates and creating new substances from that interaction, I thought. Be good to clarify that. Can someone else give us some input on that as to what their understanding is on that concept?
Thank you, Rick.
I think that came up, what, maybe 2 or 3 weeks ago? Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, so who else has got something about that? maybe someone on the live stream, or how many people on the live stream?
And Mario, you mentioned about controlling or setting the pH with the GANs, and introducing, you know, these type of special environments in water to create the constant pH. It's something which, you know, nowadays, Jackie, Mr. Cash, and yesterday in the Canadian presentation, Francois also talked about, you know, how to create a pH, special pH in water pools, on any type of water, you know, closed water environments. This is what you wanted to mention?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yeah. Because yeah, the whole thing with the Filipino present, the Philippine fellas did the presentation on, you know, neutralizing the really acidic water that they had by using the, not even introducing the GANs. I think you could just put a copper plate. I'm not sure which ways they were doing it, but I don't remember. But yeah, using the GANs power to basically decontaminate your water and set the pH. You know?
Mr. Cash talked about in his pool about using, there's a plate. I think he used a copper plate.
Right. In a plastic bag,
yeah. And was there a zinc plate too, or just the copper?
No, I think just copper. Just one little copper plate, I think.
Found that the pH stayed quite high in his pool enough that it kept it disinfected.
And he also mentioned that to put it into a plastic bag, maybe a CO2 patch.
Well, it was the fellas in Arizona that have the manufacturing. He separated his dirty caustic with a nano-coated tube.
Yes, I tried that. It works.
Yes.
You guys believe them?
And it's, you get pure water on top. I'm not drinking it, but, you know.
Well, I think it works, though.
It probably is drinkable, actually, oddly enough.
I was just thinking that earlier today, in fact, and that's something we need to do is, for example, take some dirty water, what's known to be contaminated with whatever thing we're trying to test, and then dump a bunch of CO2 GANs in it and do another test with the CO2 GANs water, and do another test with the copper oxide and GANs and the copper oxide GANs water, and you know, CH3 as well, and any other GANSes we'd like to test, to see, to do some actual tests to see if the water is purified and to what degree. You know, it's pretty easy to get water tests done. It would be some expense, I guess. But surely we can get some sort of accredited lab or somebody that can, you know, keep the controls and the variables all together, so we can understand more about that and try to get the try to nail it down. That would be such a service to, for example, it just came up in the news a couple of days ago that there's a native community up north and they're suffering from mercury contamination in their water supply and have been since the 1960s, for crying out loud. And the government's been saying, well, it'll just go away. And it hasn't. It's gotten worse. And now they've, you know, got birth defects and they're dealing with the effects of, because they still fish from the area that they're so isolated. That's their only source of food and so on. And they need to have that whole river system cleaned up. And maybe it's something that, you know, you just have to find as close to the source as you can get and dump a whole whack of, you know, CO2 GANs in or something.
You know, I'm ready to testify what I've done for myself or everybody. I'm from Detroit and I want to keep an update going on this. Mm-hmm. That, you know, what I did, I got a freaked out situation. I put everything in the toilet and it was 20 gallons of GANs. And I don't think the guys in Africa over there, you know, they're using small amounts, you know, they're using like minute amounts to fix what they're doing. I made a big boo-boo that I'm holding to it. I don't care about. I'm taking ownership of it. Mm-hmm. I put down 20 gallons of Gantz, and it was good stuff. I made it myself, and I put a lot of good intention in it. And mm-hmm. I just want to put it out there again that I did that. It's in our water system. I'm in Detroit, and guess what? I'm in the most violent area of Detroit. Come on, people know Detroit, Michigan is so violent that they'll come up to you and stick their gun in your car and say, get out, leave the purse, and you're lucky.
I've heard these stories since I was a kid about the Detroit area, and it turned out I went to university in Flint, which is right next to it. It's the same thing. It's just gunfights with gangs all the time. And, you know, it was quite incredible that way. Yeah. So
I live here every day. You can turn, you know, it's not national news, but every day there's a killing or a shooting or a baby. Now it's gotten to the point where the gangs shoot the babies because the parents got to adhere to what they want. You know what I'm saying? They're killing their children.
Right.
Parents adhere to their crimes. But guess what? I'm in Detroit. People fear Memorial Day because it's a violent day, because a lot of people don't have to work, and a lot of people are out drinking and partying and having a good time. And it was very warm. It was a great holiday here. And guess what? No murders, no killings, no shootings, no death. It was incredible for me as a person to hear this. I'm thinking, like, come on. I'm in Detroit. There's got to be somebody got held up or carjacked or something every day from Friday to today.
Yeah.
There should have been some carjacking. Now, I don't take any credit for it. I hope that something's happening here.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. That's for sure.
And so there's no doubt. Mr. Keshno, I put a little bit too much more than the guys over in Africa are working with.
He's talked recently about the guys in China are now producing like literally tons per day of gas. Wow.
Gentlemen, you guys talking about John Bleven from Arizona. I invited John, and John is here with us right now. He can actually talk first to the hand from the things that he did with water purification.
Oh, great. John, I don't want to take any. Yes.
That's great. And you know, Mark, think about Flint and the trouble they've had in their water supply with the lead that's been leached out of their lead pipes by the high acidity and so on in the water supply. And now there's no doubt that the GANs can. Or nanoparticles in particular, and the copper oxide GANs for sure, and probably the CO2 GANs too, can take out those lead ions out of the water and are able to stabilize them and so on. And
they shifted over to the Detroit water system, which is this is what happened. The stuff that I put in is in the system now.
Oh, okay. Well, that's very interesting. Yes.
Let me just say this. In the system now, a West Virginia water professor just told the people in Flint, it's not clean enough to drink yet, but it's clean enough to bathe in. And that's a step in the right direction.
Right.
You know, enough is starting to work. The people aren't going like, you know, water's going back up there. People are a little bit less freaked out about it. And hopefully... Let's all have a positive thought that this can cure water. I know it can cure water. So
what you are talking about, I just shared this frame yesterday we had with Rick. We were in a Canadian presentation, so Francois and the Canadian Cash Foundations and manufacturers. And this little picture, what I'm sharing right now, is explaining that under 1 hour, you got... you know, you put a, I mean, Rick, are you speak French or you don't?
A little bit, yeah.
Can you verify the informations over here? What I see is under 1 hour, you got 500 liter of water, purified by the CO2 gas. But if you wait another 24 hours, this mixture is going to energize the water, 30,000 of these, and 25,000 water. If you put 1 milliliter of CO2 gas, it take 44 day to basically energize that amount of waters. Am I correct?
Yeah, 25,000 gallons. It says, yeah, you mentioned 25,000 water or something. 25,000 gallons with 1 milliliter.
Right, 25,000 gallons.
44 days to.
So you can, we can imagine. I just wanted to share this. We can imagine what is the reactions that are going on right now in Detroit. So John is here. I invited John. If you guys want to, he can explain what he did.
Sure, that'd be great.
So we've been experimenting quite a bit with water. It's kind of one of my personal passions to do water purification. I've been in contact with some of the local municipalities trying to get them on board with doing some of the testing for us because they have equipment that we don't. What we see is how there's a settling effect to I'll say contaminated water. We had some problems with our caustic materials where we did various hot caustic procedures. And we ended up collecting all the materials from that. And it got to the point where there was so much of the materials that we had to figure out how to purify it. So we put a vial of CO2 water, actually CO2 itself, and a copper nano-coated rod inside of it that was sealed. And then we put that in the corner of a big bucket. And the next day, that whole big bucket, and it was a shoebox-sized container filled with dirty caustic water, the next day, all the caustic completely settled to the bottom, and everything in between was clear. Now, whether, you know, whether it was, I wouldn't put it in the drinkable category, but it was, the sediment had settled. So there's some other things that we're trying, is we think that the water, so there's been some study, some things that have come out where you can basically put a container of purified water in a polluted pond, and that the energies that are in that container of, I'll say purified water, will transfer to the rest of the water to the point where the stagnant pond can become purified. And that's been documented way back when, but the studies have been blocked. So I think there's a lot that's to be learned with this water purification. I'm on our side, I'm not one to go and, you know, put it in municipal places right now. We're trying to get the local municipalities to participate with us so that they can document some of the results and bring them forward in a collective manner.
Yeah, and there's agencies that are actively trying to, there's just a report that came out about nanoparticles in the environment, and they did tests on zinc oxide and four or five other substances and discovered that it is prevalent in the environment and so on. They couldn't actually pinpoint any damage done by the zinc oxide in particular, but it's something that's found in virtually all the water and soil of the earth right now due to our uses of everything from cosmetics to just literally millions of tons or somewhere in the hundreds of thousands of tons are used every year of zinc oxide. As a nanoparticle.
John?
Place. Yes.
Are you John from Arizona?
Yes, I am.
Well, I respect you very much, and you have a lot of pull. And if you'd like, you can call the municipality here in I live in Mount Clemens, Michigan.
Uh-huh.
And if you want to talk to the people at the municipality that runs the sanitation department where the water would be going down to, I'd be curious, but I don't know. If I called them, they'd say to me, who are you? Maybe if you called them and you had some sort of representation for the Keshe Foundation, and you just asked them if they had noticed any type of change in their readings in their sewer, because I put it all down in the sewer. The one test that was just said, they did like a milliliter of per 500,000 gallons. I put down 4 5 gallon buckets of GANS material between CO2, CO, CHO, all the ones that we've made so far were all mixed together.
Let's try to do it in a fashion where we bring them on board rather than take things into our own hands. Because when we take things into our own hands and just do them on our own.
Oh, I didn't do this on my own. I was scared as all son of a gun. I had an experience that scared me from now until tomorrow.
Okay. So one of the things that I recommend, and this can go not only for you, but for all the people that are listening, is there's going to be a point in our practice here where we have to reach out to our communities in which we live and solicit the backing and support for the greater community. In other words, we're a collective now, and that collective needs to be inclusive and not exclusive. And what I'm doing here in my community here in Arizona is we have what's called the Central Arizona Water Group, and they have all kinds of different...
John, I don't mean to interrupt you, but I made a big mistake. And I have to live with this every day I wake up now. Okay, I didn't do this on purpose.
Yeah, I'm familiar with your story.
I'm scared as all get-go. Okay, I did...
Mark, can I come in here a second?
Yes.
I have to say something that... this is my belief, but I think when I say this, I think most of you, if not all of you, are going to agree with it. None of us are here by accident. Every one of us have been doing what is supposed to happen when it was supposed to happen for reasons that are above our level of understanding. You did what you did because whatever your reasons for doing it, you did it because it was the right time for somebody like you to come along and do what you did. It's a grand scheme here. Like it's like fate, you know, it determines our positions. But like the way I see it, like somebody like Rick, what the role he's playing in this has to be there. It was written thousands of years ago. Somebody like Rick is going to come along and do what he did. But here's the other thing. If it wasn't Rick, it would be somebody else. It would be...
It's not like it's me. Look at me. I try not to make myself the icon, but I'm temporarily a representative of this change that's going on or whatever. But it's not... You're exactly right. If I keeled over tomorrow, there'd be another Rick-like entity that would sort of take over that aspect of whatever it is that I do. The same as if all of us that are... sort of on that leading edge, basically, we're all dispensable.
It's you, because you chose to do it.
Yeah, that is definitely part of it. But in the other sense, it's in
yes, the Mark, really Mark, big you, picture. You, what you did, and what Mario explained, and Ricky, that's correct. What John is actually explaining is more of the followable and how can I workable steps to go. So whatever you did already, and God knows, you needed to do that. But what John explaining, you know, how manufacturers, which are making and playing a very important rules of cash foundation structure and to supporting of spreading the technology and products around the world, is very important that these bricks, which we are laying down right now around the world, and John, one of these, is they have to be in a solid rock foundations, and you know, as much as we can, we have to go side by side with the regulations, as what John explained, he's bringing into a board, into discussions, and showing them, you know, what's going on. Let them ask the help from John, and John going to supply most likely the materials to them, then they can do a laboratory test, and they will come back, and you know, this is the process. Otherwise, we were just going to give them an area where we can get vulnerable. You know, they can attack us, and you know, they can do all sorts of things. It's very delicate, you know, balance what we have to maintain. Exactly. Am I correct? This is what you feel?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, for example, as I was mentioning, this has come up recently, especially in Europe, and they have a new organization that takes control of all the nanotechnology. And they, of course, want only their nanotechnology to be what's happening. So they've now trying to establish rules to ban certain types of nanotechnology and make sure it's all controlled and doesn't get into the environment and this kind of thing. And that, yes, they'll definitely, and our authorities will be looking at this kind of thing, because there's lots of kinds of nanoparticles. Some of them are extremely nasty to be taking inside of one's body. And what if someone was out there, you know, trying to poison environments rather than trying to clean them up? Well, the authorities don't know what's, you know, what's what, and half of us don't, and even the ones that think they do maybe don't as well, as far as these, you know, we haven't been able to measure exactly what we have, for example, to start with.
Interesting. You brought up the nanotechnology. I worked for more than 10 years with nanotechnology, but the most dangerous nanotechnology is produced by those who try to control the technology.
So, yes, you know, right. No doubt. But you
know, such a you know, freaky stuff, small little nano robots, etc., etc. But to go back to the subject of John talking about how the water purification, you know, how if you have a purified water, how that purified water can have effect. By saying that, I worked together with the late Masaru Emoto, and I'm continuously having a good relationship with the family, Hiromasa Emoto, his son, and the new president of Hado Institute in Tokyo. Their job for decades is basically studying water and how the water is formed, crystallized under certain temperature, and revealing the informations. And they had many amazing tests and you know, thoughts of the prayer. You know, the person prayed right next to the down water, and they did the test before and after, so how it changed and etc. So yes, this is very important, and the water molecules shapes, the hexahedral shapes is also take a very important part. When human drink the water, your bodies basically have to shape the water molecules to create the hexahedral to order to penetrate the water into the cells itself. So there are so many the things, if you want to go into really scientific of producing things. But you know, if Armin would be here, he would say no, hell no. What you need to do is just focus on plasma and energy and etc. But yeah, that's very interesting subject you brought up, John.
So one of the things with and you just touched on it, Sylvester, is the crystals. The crystals can be a broadcaster of frequencies. So when frequencies into the water, whatever we put them in, and then have them broadcast with crystals or crystal dust. A lot of times what I'll do is take small crystals and break them up into crystal dust. If we put those into, say, a test tube with CO2 water and CuO water, it would be interesting to see some of the results associated with it.
Yes, you see, crystals are very famous storing information. For example, the mountain crystal, the pure mountain crystal is one of the crystals which can hold a, you know, they say it in Buddhism and other religion, the blessing, which is a holy energy. You know, they can store these crystals for long enough. And also there are certain methods you can purify crystals by fire. It means taking off all the memory stored in the crystal. And then you can charge it up. For thousands and thousands of years, 30, 40, 50, 60,000 years ago, you know, people had a large understanding of crystals. This is why they wear it on the jewelries and crowns and, you know, different things on the body. Now we lost this knowledge. Now we only like the shiny and yes, some people, they deep digging into this understanding and trying to understand again. But for the water itself, water is like a memory card. This can memorize everything what you think, everything what you say, everything what you do. You put some picture, some visual informations next to the water. The water learn these information, reflecting this in this form. Then you can just focus on certain thoughts, and you can write something on a bottle. We made a very interesting portable. I mean, I'm talked about, you know, Mr. Cash brought up this recently about creating portable manufacturing facility units, like a container size units. My company in Europe, we had a network of research groups around the world, but we focused the work in Europe and in Hungary. We put together a 40-foot container, portable water purifications and water programming device, which could produce 28,000 liter of water every 8 hour, basically by having a mobile units attached in the beginning of the device. You can use any dirty water, mud water or river water or lake water, or by using the right component, you can even use the salty water, or you can get the water out of the air, because I personally, my company, you know, we purchased a unit back in 2004, which unit was producing drinking water, purified drinking water from the air. They used the... Sorry?
I just wanted to say hi to Libby.
You said the brand, right?
No, Libby. She's a lady in Nova Scotia that goes crazy with doing natural nano coating.
Okay, thank you. So I don't know what brand was this device, but it's basically used the air to get the moisture out of it. Also, there are other techniques how to get the water. If you are in the desert, in early morning, you know, they use techniques like they're putting out a large net, and that net is basically collecting the moisture out of the air. So anyway, you know, you can have all sorts of alternatives to collect the water. Then you do the basic purification, then you put it into a programming parts when you program and energize the water. We have a special energizing technology called Ionexo Pure, and we use this Ionexo Pure technology to create pH alkaline water, three times more hydrating the human body.
Are you
body.
Trying to sell us a system?
No, I'm telling you what technology already exists in the world, and we talked about. I'm telling you guys what work we did in this field. So because John brought up the idea of the water, purified water is doing, you know, I think you don't want to sell dumping gas into the facility, into your, you know, in everywhere. And this
well,
is
not a mistake. We're moving on from that. We
don't I'm not selling anything over here. I don't think so. Anyone want to sell anything. What we're doing, we're sharing informations and
apologize for what I did.
No. I'm not saying that you don't need to apologize. I'm just explaining when you're saying I'm selling something, I'm just telling you that I'm not selling anything.
You accessed a company that you did and you're selling and we're sleepy. And for a lot of us, this is a group that we're trying to move on and trying to make a reactor. We're trying to get some reaction out of something that is nothing.
You know, take a breath there, Mark. Sylvester's a very important person to listen to.
Okay. So I'm sorry.
I appreciate you.
Maybe don't you know. Thank you. This is the only reason why I'm explaining this information, because again, yesterday and systematically, time to time, since Mr. Cash announced the mobile manufacturing facility and mobile manufacturing thing, now John is here. I received several questions from around the world, manufacturers, they're asking these questions, and I'm trying to bring new information up, and sorry if I'm not introduced myself.
I absolutely apologize for that.
You don't need to. Exactly.
I'm so sorry. I didn't mean.
No, nothing. You know, sorry. I mean,
I try to bring nothing but love and good intentions, and I'm so scared here.
No, you don't need to be. Don't be scared, as you can see, everybody is sharing. Thank you, Rick. Thank you, Rick. So, John, I don't know if John, this is something what you wanted to hear. I mean, you ask, some explanation.
Yeah, I thought that was very good. I think we're all going to kind of move in those directions, and the fact that you've already been down some of this path is helpful to us all.
John, you know, I wanted to talk with you just before Rick workshop started, but I joined the workshop because you watched the international workshop just now. So I would like to leave this workshop right now. I would like to talk with John. So it is always my pleasure to be here, Rick, and it is amazing group, Mario and everybody, you know, is amazing over here, you know, sharing all these informations and ideas.
Well, thanks for your input too, Sylvester. You've got lots of interesting experiences at high levels that you can add to here. So really appreciate your input. Thank you.
I do my humble work, and forgive me if I sometimes I look like a salesman. I started as a salesman, but I hope I grew out.
Yeah, well, if you hang out here, we'll get it out of you.
I just wanted to say I'm sorry, Sylvester. I didn't mean that. It's just
like Mark in level. I'm Mark. In a virtual level, I'm hugging you. And as again, as everybody pointed out, we are here because we need to be here. We did everything in our life go through on certain things because God is the pot master. The life is the spinning table, and the mud is ourself. So when life is spinning, God putting His hand on the mud and forming us. Sometimes we need to lose certain things. Sometimes it's very painful. We getting up shapes which you never had before. But in the end, our container is going to be large enough to collect the wisdom of God, which coming from above. So God bless for everyone. And I thank you for Rick and everybody who's here.
Well, you don't have to leave.
No, it's just that I prepared a talk from Don John. There's certain things from manufacturing related things we need to talk, sometimes it's very difficult to reach each other.
Yeah. All right. Well, good luck with it all.
Thank you, John.
Are you coming? Okay. Give me a call. By the way, Lee, I saw a lot of the stuff that you're doing. You're doing great work. We're doing some of the stuff. It's very similar to what you're doing. And we've learned a lot from you. So good work.
Gotta say, I love this group. I love the interaction. Because we're all coming from the same place, you know. Hopefully from a humble place.
Thank you, Tony.
Is that live, Rick, or is that a
previous? No, this is Memorex. This is recorded, yeah. I just rediscovered this video yesterday, so I thought I'd throw it up as a example of the generating that central core and the ring effect from the CO2 GANs. You can see the right. core going down there now.
Wow.
You see the little bubble at the end of the core, these little bubbles. Yeah. They are the strangest thing that I've run into in quite some time, actually. I've done some other experiments with turning this whole apparatus sideways. And these little bubbles will stay there. They will not mix in with either the water or the air in the center. They just bounce around. And they'll keep their entity-ness without mixing with the other bubbles. There'll be a half a dozen bubbles that will be, they won't mix with the other ones or with themselves or any the environment. They keep their own entity-ness, like little plasma balls at the end there. It's the strangest thing. I'd like to investigate that phenomenon more, actually. So I'm going to reinvigorate the water's apparatus. Going because
if that's a sealed container, you're somehow compressing that water to create the space for that.
Well, it's not totally sealed, actually. It's open at the other end, and I've got the ability to actually vacuum it out if I wish, or put gases or pressure in, or more liquid, or whatever, through a rotating assembly up there.
Oh, okay.
Do we have a way of nano-coating glass yet?
Well, that's a good question, and I mean, there are technical ways of doing it. For example, the best way to nanocoat glass, I think, for a reactor, for the type that I would be interested in, I want to follow through on, is a gold coating, a gold nanorod coating on the inside. And if you had a perfect sphere with a gold nanorod coating, coating on the inside of the glass. Gold nanorods are the best room temperature form of diamagnetic substance. So it would essentially reflect any magnetic field into the center of the sphere. And I think that would be a great way to do it.
Another option that I sort of stumbled into is using silver. If you make colloidal silver in a glass container, you will essentially silver coat the inside of that container.
Right, and there are official ways of doing it as well. You have to etch the glass first in a certain way, I think nitric acid, I believe, something like that. And then you use the silver, and it's called silvering. It's just making a mirror. You silver it on the back of the glass, so you got a nice mirror. So maybe silvering on the outside of the sphere, when you think about it, maybe that's the best way to go. And it would be a perfect mirror on the inside. Well, not perfect because it's silver. It's only 98% or something like that. So you have actually quite a loss in that sense. That's why I was thinking of the gold nanorods, which would be relatively easy to do with a simple gold plating process and a couple of fancy processes to get the gold nanorods. Not that fancy.
I think Armin said last week that you can paint CH3 on it, and then you don't have to nanocoat the inside if you use the liquid plasma. Because that up against the glass does nano. That was my understanding.
Right. Well, that could very well be. That makes more sense. And the way, if you look at the picture now, for example, that GANS, if it was a GANS water that was a different density, at least, than the regular water, then it would be on that, it would be coating that the wall of the glass. Such that in a similar way to the early reactors where you had different gases that were used instead of GANSes, and the gases would, for example, the neon would be an insulating layer, and then you'd have the argon as well to be against the wall of the container, and they act to reflect the plasma and keep it in the center and keep everything, keep the energies from contaminating the outside and keep the keep it where it's supposed to be on the inside and so on. So maybe the GANS water itself.
Can you paint CH3 on a glass ball? I haven't really tried that yet.
Can you paint what? CH3?
Yeah, that's what Armin was saying to do, because it sticks to the plastic. You know, the plastic will always be a little bit red if you leave it.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, that's a good question. I mean, I've never seen it. I haven't seen it.
Balls.
I haven't seen it stay on the glass, so far as I know. But this actual globe has had GANS in it for quite some time, and I think it does have a bit of a stain. I'm going to go have a look. I'll be right back.
Mario?
Yeah?
If you had a glass disc like this, can you see it?
Yes.
How would you nanocoat this?
Well, paint it with CH3.
Well...
And
it's sticking on the glass a bit, but it looks like it would wash off quite readily. I think what you would have to do would be similar to using an acid or some other type of etching process to give a slight etch.
How would we change the condition of the surface of a glass surface?
Right, well, that's what I was saying. You can use an acid, like I think it's nitric acid that will etch glass. There's some particular
caustic won't penetrate the silicon in the glass.
No, I think it's different. I think that the crystal, just like Sylvester was talking about, stores information.
Yes.
So just painting it on there, even if it washes off, the presence of those fields are going to get stored in the crystalline structure of the glass itself. You shouldn't even need to etch it. It should be a field transfer into the glass. But I don't know if Armin meant that, because he didn't say anything about anything else. And he had his reactors. He had two of them were copper and two of them were glass, I think he said, right? He had the two of them that were glass. And he said, you want to know how to nanocoat the outside of your reactors? I assumed he meant those. He said, paint them with CH3. And then I asked what about the inside? And he said, you don't have to, you have the liquid plasma. But, you know, that's my remembering of it. Maybe I got it wrong at the time.
I think that's about right.
Mm-hmm.
So just painting it on there basically transfers those fields and nanocoats to the outside of presumably anything, I guess.
So Kesh said, if we take surfaces that can stick GANS material, so I was thinking, see, I bought these things, but if we took a real fine paintbrush and made a diamond and a square and a round one down here of GANS.
Let me see, I can't see, sorry, I couldn't see your picture here because I have my other thing. Let's stop this for a bit and get a look at yours there so I can... There, that's better. Thank you.
My thought process was, like Mario's, I don't know how I found these things. At the thrift store, these are glass six-inch...
Wow, that's beautiful. I would have grabbed it at the thrift store, too.
And there were six of them.
They don't have thrift stores in Bangkok or Shanghai. I don't
really?
Know. No stores either. You know, you guys.
Oops. Mark's audio is gone here for me. What happened? Maybe it's still on my end?
No, I can't hear mine.
Okay, your audio. Something happened there, Mark.
Just switch your audio back on,
here, Mark. I'll unmute you there. There, go ahead now.
Better?
Yeah, now I can hear you.
Okay. So I had to get flowers for my mom at Mother's Day. and the thrift store is right next door to the flower store. So I walked in there, and these were there calling me. Lots of them. So anyway, let's get beyond that. So Mr. Keshe said to so I bought these things. So he said, take our Gantz. And I thought to myself, I got to wash all the dirtiness off of all these glass, the history of the glass, right? I want to wash the history of the glass and everything that's connected to it. And I thought the caustic soda, you know, through heat opens the silicon in the glass. Because I bought the roasting pan that takes the temperature of any liquid, anything you put in a roasting pan will take the liquid temperature up to 500 degrees. I had a crock pot, but it only took the liquid up to like 160 or 180 degrees. So I bumped it up. I went to the thrift store, got a roasting pan. Now the roasting pan will get me to that level. So my thinking is, if we open up the surface, you know, like the surface of glass is made at 1,800 degrees. If I can get the surface of the glass opened up to about 500 degrees, maybe something will happen here where it will react. Now I take my Gantz that I've been making, and I make a diamond shape in the Gantz on this top, and I make a square on this on the third, and on the bottom here I make a round ring. That's what I'm hoping for fields. I'm moving out of this all this stuff, and I want to go to fields. So look what else they gave me as a bonus.
Interesting.
That's a strange looking. So now, in my mind, I'm thinking, I should paint with a fine brush of Gantz on the outside and the inside, different materials. And I know how to make the Gantz materials now. And I'm just, this is all good stuff, but I'm still stuck on pH.
Yeah, going back to pH, I went.
Hi, while John. You guys were talking, I love you, John.
I went dug out my pH meter and did a few readings. I've got a Milwaukee pH 600 that's it's kind of old, but it's pretty stable. What I came up with, the CO2 Gantz that I've got running in the kitchen right now in a plastic container with the zinc on the outside and a nano-coated coil running down the center came out at 7.6. This Gantz, which I created in Chilliwack using 19 volts computer power supply, so it's pretty much zinc oxide, that came out at 8.4.
Still in livable condition.
Yep. This Gantz, which is my latest CO2, which is the really light baby blue stuff, that came out at 7.1.
John, do you have your video going?
That's all washed.
Your spotlighting Mark's okay. Video.
I didn't see you there. I had to open my window more. Let me spotlight.
There we go.
There we go. There we thanks. Go.
Okay.
Now let me stop.
Milwaukee pH 600. That's the meter I used. And the Gantz I have in the kitchen, like I said, I can't bring it out here because it's too fragile. It'll just come apart. It came out at 7.6. This stuff, which is mostly zinc oxide, I suspect. It's very thick. It's like toothpaste. The water in there came out at 8.4. My latest CO2, which the doesn't really show it, but it's a very, very light baby blue, very cloud-like. That came out at 7.1, and I tested my distilled water, which I get at Safeway, and it came out at 6.5. So 6.5. Clearly distilled water is not pH neutral.
That's no. Interesting. I think that to get pH neutral.
This is tap water, which is around here, it's kind of alkaline. This ran through a carbon block filter to take out the chlorine and other crap that's in the water, because the chlorine's so high here you can't drink it. And it goes through my fridge and it comes out cool water. And this came out at 7.0.
Wow.
Thank you for sharing that, John. It's under here.
Yep.
We have to know about distilled water. If you make distilled water in a proper way, heating up to create vapors, to make a refrigerant, a cooler, which is at least at 40, 50 centimeters distance from the top of the water, and then to cool it down, like it's making moonshine, for instance, by using a still, then you get pure distilled water, which has to have pH 7, neutral. But what happens? As soon as a pure distilled water is in contact with air, the air contains different other components, like carbon dioxide. The water starts to dissolve a part of the carbon dioxide from the air, and immediately it becomes slightly acid, like soda water.
Yes.
That's why always, if you have distilled water, then it gets at an acid pH. It can go up to 5.5. Usually 6.5, 6, and so on, depending of how much carbon dioxide it absorbs from the air.
Is there any way to control that?
You have to make in such a way that as soon as you fill a bottle with a glass bottle by distilled water, to put a plug immediately.
Yeah, when
deionized means process.
Pardon me?
Not distilled. It's an ion exchange.
But it would be pH neutral, right?
It's others, it's removing the scale, the lime of it, but it's far from distilled water.
Yeah, it's a little bit more stable.
It's filtered water, but let's still don't filter viruses and hormones and other things which are in tap water.
Yeah, deionized water is a little more stable than like regular tap water because it's not as reactive. But when you add carbon dioxide to water, the carbon strips some of the water molecules off and increases the oxygen rate, lowers the potential hydrogen. That's why your pH drops. Now, why it would fluctuate so much? Yeah, there could be dissolved gases in there that are altering the chemistry, but you're going to always have some dissolved hydrogen, some dissolved oxygen in that water. It's almost impossible to get rid of that.
Probably so there depends needs, on I, the I'm container.
Sure, there's
as
a
well.
Range that we can work with. That's going to,
we're never going to have a pristine, you know, environment across the board. We've got to work in the real world, you know.
But we could take measurements beforehand enough to, so we know, you know, is it a 6 pH, 7 pH, 8 pH? We need to know the approximate range, even if it's just a litmus test. Literally, I think we should pay more attention to that.
What does that feel, neutral? Is it,
I can't hear you, John. Your microphone went off for some reason. And I do hear you, Mario. Could you say that again? Go ahead again.
Yeah. What are we trying to get? A completely neutral water to start with?
This is another question. Perhaps, for example, when you're creating the CO2 GANS. Maybe it's better to have a more acidic environment or a more alkaline environment for productivity and for purity. We haven't really done the full test on that, I don't think. I mean, that is something that should be baseline. We should do immediately, you know, maybe we can.
I'm sorry. I put a monkey in the wrench.
Okay.
That's a baseline, and John, you know, like all the different readings you took, I think pH can change from day to day, from sunlight to gloomy days. Every person's pH is different because it's our essence. You know, it's our energy that's being put forth upon anything that we're making. So if it's a it's pH is an energy in the water, which we're trying to measure, then everybody's pH is different. You know what I'm saying? So I think for a baseline, and this is what I'm trying to get at. This was, I couldn't wait for this day to come, today to come, because I didn't want to spend more money to try to figure out what I'm doing, because I wanted to figure out the baseline is the pH, because it fluctuates every day. Some of my Ganses would get real fluffy and big, some wouldn't do anything at all, and I didn't know how much salt I had in it. And there was a day, a meeting where Rick told me, hey, don't let that water content or that salt get below that the top of it. And standards, I'm a painter. I didn't even graduate high school, and I'm learning all this physics stuff today, and I love it. And I'm thankful for all you guys. And I don't mean to keep butting in, but I took it to the root. I try to take it to the root and the root is the pH. It's the balance of how we live. We were created in water.
Yeah, very much so. But on the other hand, like I was saying before, our blood pH is in a very narrow band, and it has to be like within a few hundredths of a pH. Or we are ill or otherwise dead and that kind of thing. So, but on the other hand, people do have a more alkaline or acid condition in their body besides just the blood itself. The cells and the structure can have a different pH. Your mouth, for example, it can have quite a range of pH in that example. So yes, you're right, and there's a lot of talk about becoming more alkaline to help with cancers and processes and that kind of thing, and hence the alkaline water.
But be careful about many false data which are given for smart people to read. Verify your sources. If somebody claims that something is better for health, which is unusual, please check for the source. Did he do some experiments? What was the experiment? How was it done? Was it done on 3 mice or on 30 mice? Was it done on humans, etc.? There is a fashion now that many people are promoting to alkalinize your body. Meanwhile, I have a friend who is a researcher doctor, is researching for tumors. So he's causing tumors to mice, and then he studies the way how the tumors are created and all the conditions, and try to find ways in his study to reduce the conditions of growth of the tumors by certain ways. And I know him by a hobby, by bow making. He's an excellent traditional historical bow maker as a hobby. And he said about this alkalinizing that the alkaline condition is just the near cancer condition. If your body gets too acid, if a tissue gets too acid, you may get ulcer. If it gets too alkaline, it gets a cancer. There are books, leaflets, and kits, do-it-yourself kits promoting to drink wheat grass juice. And all veterinarians know that you are not allowed to let your cattle and horses, etc., to eat the wheatgrass, because it has so much potassium in it that it produces a very severe intoxication called tetania. When you see the symptoms, you already cannot do anything to save the animal. And they are selling such kits for humans to grow their own wheatgrass and to make juice of it and to drink it.
Well, that's the thing. You don't alkalize.
This is backed up. This is financed and backed up by those who are selling chemistry for, how to say this, for the illness industry, not health industry.
Yeah, well, to alkalize the body, then you introduce an acid, and that's how you can alkalize. That's the mistake they're making by trying to introduce an alkaline to alkalize the body, because the body responds the opposite the way you introduce something. It'll try to create balance. For example, if you the idea that I got with alkalizing the body was to go on a lemon juice fast. And the lemon juice creates an alkaline condition in the body such that you can cure a stomach ulcer with lemon juice, for example.
There are different ways, but take care of what you take. We had a very popular actor, a movie star here in Hungary, a local small movie star. They said it's the Hungarian Bud Spencer. And his name was István Bújtor, rest in peace. A couple of years ago, because he was overweighted and a bit older, he read such a books about living healthier, and he started to do a fasting by taking only vegetable juices. And finally, he went to hospital when his all goods stopped working and the electrolytic balance of the body was bottom up.
Sandor?
Yeah.
Sandor, are we on the same page as that we need a balanced alkalitic and acidic, which means where do we find that pH balance? Is it 7, 8, 5, 9, 3, 4? Where does it sit? That's the standard that I'm trying to
figure out. Do you mean in yourself or
I consider that our body is developed in conditions of the planet.
Yes.
What is good for an Inuit is maybe a poison for somebody who is living in New Delhi in India, and he's a Brahmin and he's a vegetarian, and vice versa.
Well, they'll find their own pH balance, don't you think?
So everyone shall take the food which makes him feel good and gives him energy.
Of course, because that's the natural way.
Yeah. You know, my grandparents, when they
think of people who have had the natural way to help them become natural again, become the balance of life. And that's the part that I'm trying to get. You know, when we introduce the alkalinity or the nano coating that goes into the salt solution, also starts a process. And that's the process that I'm trying to figure out. Once you put the nano coating into the salt solution, how much of that between the NOA, do we need to make that process happen? You know what I'm saying? We need to figure out the standard to, sometimes people put too much sodium caustic in the balance and it takes it up to 12, 13, 14. You don't want
to. And sometimes people forget to rinse their nanocoated plates and they leave the caustic on.
Right, exactly. But they're still making this nice fluffy Gantz with all that, and they're thinking that that's good, and it's not that good because the alkalinity is so high that they could never use that in their system. It's not compatible. If the alkalinity of the system is at 18 and the body and the Gantz should be at 7 or 8 or 9, how in the world could be compatible with Gantz that's at 18?
So there is an easy way how to get that out of many such variables
vinegar?
Vinegar? We have learned that using the water, the energized water from the top of the Gantz, which we can dilute shake it again with clean water and repeat that process. We obtain a water which preserves the energies of the original GANS, same like in homeopathy. And you don't need to take any single molecule of the GANS or whatever was in the initial water.
Right.
This is very powerful. Recently, a couple of weeks ago, we had a Romanian scientist, Mr. Vlad Teodorescu, who was studying, he's doing researches for seeking for the water of life since over 30 years. He was colleague of the past Zaharescu, who came the first time with polymerized water and left spinning and right spinning water polymers and so on in the 80s. And he had shown us such interesting things. For instance, if you shake that GANS with water, so what actually this gentleman did, he diluted his GANS water, and he diluted it again, and he has shaken in the hands, and to be more sure for a stronger effect, he didn't shake with one hand, he hold the bottle in two hands altogether. And when he made the dilution of 10,000 times, already it was so much energy that he felt such electric shocks in his heart. So he stopped. So he thought that this is due to the energy, not due to other things. It said in 48 hours it has to go away. So it happened like that. So recently another person, Dan Mironescu, did the same, and he feel the same. Also, this Vlad Teodorescu has shown us a very interesting instrument to measure the quality of water, which gives us much more better clues than a pH measurement. He used the capacity meter with a special probe. The probe has been made by two cylinders, which are concentrical, such as stainless steel cylinders, one inside the other, not very thick, like the thickness of a thumb. And this is connected to a capacimeter, which measures on a very wide range, from picofarads up to millifarads. And he used to use that for many years for checking the quality of spring waters. And he said waters which were better for health, which were more energizing, has a higher value in terms of capacity, which scientists cannot explain by their usual theories. So he said that this may be very good for testing the qualities of GANSes or GANS waters. Another instrument which he advised, it's the simple TDS meter. What does it mean, TDS? Total dissolved solids. You can buy on eBay or on other places such a TDS meters, sometimes combined with pH meters, salinity meters as well, or conductivity meters. It's a gadget of $10, $20, $30.
I just think that the pH is where we got to go, but guess what? Guess what, brother? I love you. We're so connected, but hi, Libby. Come online and tell us how good you're doing right now, because my heart feels for you. I want to just say hi to you. Come on. Put your camera on and tell us what you're doing.
Hello, may I continue what I started? It's not very long. About the TDS meter.
Please go ahead, Sandra.
So with the TDS meter, normally it estimates the volume of total dissolved solids. And it's different than the total suspension solids. So this is actually the total solids which were going through a 2 micrometer filter. But what happens when he made against water and he diluted against water and he diluted again and he diluted again, and practically at the end it was a 10,000 times dilution, so practically there should be no dissolved solids as well at all. No, it's not possible to have any solids inside or any chemicals dissolved, only the energies of the GANS. Guess what? It made such a big measurement, big value measurement, that it turned out of the scale the TDS meter.
Wow.
So it's measuring based on conductivity. And you see the pure distilled water has a poor, very poor conductivity. But when you energize it with GANS and you dilute it and shake and dilute and shake again, practically you remove all the traces of the GANS and you have only water, which is energized, and that becomes conductive. Don't you think that maybe very useful for transferring the energies better in the body? Because what's the main role of the water in the body? It's transferring energies.
So Sandor, you're saying if we're gonna use all the water we use to harvest the GANSes or whatever we're gonna do, to put a drop of the water of the GANS to purify it first. Is that what basically? Right.
Put 1 milliliter, not one drop. Put 1 milliliter into a glass of water and shake it, but shake it well. So Mr. Cash told us about the shaking, and he has a very, very good paper, The Secrets of the Homeopathy, which you can find on the website, on the cashfoundation.org website in the webshop.
Yes. But like when you're going to use salt water, so you put the distilled water, you put a little bit of the liquid GANS from whatever, and then you add your salt, and then you make whatever GANS you want.
Same you don't thing. Add any more salt after that. You harvested the water from the top of the GANS. It's containing salt. You dissolve it in clean distilled water. Then you take a part of that distilled water and you dissolve it again. You shake it well, and you take out a small quantity in another vial or another bottle or jar, whatever you use, and you shake it again with more distilled water, and you dilute it. Finally, at the end, you will have no molecules of salt or whatever in the final product, but you will have the energies of the GANS. And measure that, diatidius meter, measure it. Take a capacity meter. Try to measure that properties of that water and what's the difference. Try it with a pH meter. What happens with that?
Right. But what I mean is, Mark was concerned about when he's going to harvest his GANS in the first place, he has to use distilled water with salt in it. And he's wondering about the pH and all that. What I was getting at is if you drop a drop of copper oxide water of the GANS into the container before you start harvesting the GANS, how is that affected? Are you gonna?
Yeah, it depends on quantities and strengths.
Sorry?
You cannot make a chemically pure GANS. Always you get a spectrum of elements. And Mr. Cash explained this so many times. You have the water in a plastic container. Then you have a zinc plate, then you have a copper plate with copper oxide on it, then you have salt. The salt also, being a sea salt, contains other minerals in small quantities, but it still contains. So it has already some energies from the copper, from the zinc, and so on. Now, when you manufacture your GANS, the distance between the electrodes, the temperature and the salinity, it will determine, and the currents which go through the plates, will determine what mixture you will get with more carbon dioxide or with more zinc oxide. An interesting way to separate this zinc oxide GANS from the GANS of CO2, also I have to refer to Vlad Teodorescu. He made an interesting experiment. He had, maybe I have to store my camera.
No.
Shouldn't I show anything? So he had such a GANS, CO2 GANS, and he washed it not with distilled water, but he washed it with salty water. So he added more salty water. And as he increased gradually the quantity of the salt in the water, suddenly a half of the GANS went to float on the top, and another half was down. Of course, this can be explained also by positioning, but also by the density, by the gravity of the water. So you know the law of Archimedes. If you have more salty water, it will float heavier things on the top.
Yes.
Yes, in the Dead Sea, you can
Sandor, we know that. We've been working with Gans for a long time. We're trying to figure out the process of how the water and the Gans is separated. Was there any caustic? You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to figure out right now. I have salt water, okay? And I've had it without any plates, without any anything, okay? I can add caustic and salt water, and I can get the same results.
Can I ask a question? I know one thing. When my grandmother was making her house soap.
Her grandmother.
Yes, and house soap, and it's an old knowledge. They used lye. They used the caustic soda.
Yes.
And water and fat.
Yes.
And oils.
Yes.
And when the process was ready, in order to precipitate out the soda, the caustic soda, out of the water, she added salt.
I want to know if the nano coating from the whatever we put in that solution now translates into that solution. So if I nano coated a plate, a copper plate, zinc plate, any plate at all, does that transfer into that cloudy solution?
Of course.
Of course.
You will have always some particles which will transfer there. Now, another interesting thing that Tom Salas, he made an experiment which we were talking about 1 year ago.
Now let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. Okay, so I take my container and I have the salt solution in it, and I have two plates connected together, not any nano coating whatsoever, two copper plates, and in the salty solution connected together with the LED in the middle, the little light in the middle. Now I'm starting to add caustic, the NO solution in the salt. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
The salt will precipitate the caustic on the bottom. So what you will get in the bottom will have the most of the caustic of the water. So this is the lesson from the salt making. They use salt to precipitate out the caustic.
I understand that part.
Why do you put an LED between two non-nano-coated copper plates? Are you expecting to get any potential difference in between the two metals of the same quality?
No, I was told that we should have a transfer from plate to plate.
Yeah, but usually from one plate of one quality to another plate of another quality. So be it a non-coated copper and a coated copper.
I don't use electricity.
No electricity here too, you see? They are just connected together.
Yes.
Here, instead of an LED, I use a nano-coated wire.
Yes.
Always already has a high resistance.
For a load, in order for it to have a load on the one side.
Yes, you can do that.
That's what you're trying to produce, is a load on the one side, which is a higher element than the other side.
Okay.
Right?
Well,
I don't know. That's what I'm asking you. I'm a painter. I don't know. I'm learning here. I'm asking you. Are you trying to create more on one side than the other by doing that? I'm at a basic point again, because...
So how do you have it? You have one container or several containers?
Six.
Okay, you have six containers.
No, in parallel.
Okay.
Parallel.
All in parallel. So you have one wire here.
Yep.
One bus.
Yes.
And you have another bus.
Yes.
Okay. And you have one nano-coated copper plate in every one?
Yes.
And some different kind of plate in the other side.
Zinc.
Yeah.
Brass.
Okay, so you have zinc, you have brass, you have iron.
Aluminum.
Whatever. Now what happens? If you have the same salinity in every one, if you have here zinc, you will have about 0.88 volts. If you have brass, you will have about 0.85 volts. If you have iron, you have 0.555 volts. If you have copper, you with nano-coated copper, you will have 0.05 volts, a smaller voltage between. If you connect them in parallel, so all the positives on one, all the negatives on the other. Now I mix the colors, sorry for that.
That's okay.
In that case, what will happen? Without putting any extra load, here you will have a higher voltage on the zinc one, you will have a lower on the copper one. So this voltage from the zinc will feed a current over the copper one. Yeah. So you enforce, and you say you are not using the energy source, but if you put them in parallel, actually they will deliver current one over the other.
Yes, I know that.
If you put them in series, it will not happen like that.
No, I know that. I understand that.
So already you have that. If you want to limit that current, where do you have to put the LED?
No, the point.
Because they're not at the parallel wires, but you have to put it in series with the plates.
I've done it both ways. But the point that I'm trying to find out is the nano or the caustic solution. If there was no caustic solution in any of those processes, okay, if we cleaned up the plates and there was no caustic solution, then what I'm trying to understand is if I add caustic to each one of those each one and took a reading of the pH so that I knew, because each metal gives off a different pH. So if I put five drops of caustic, you know, because they're both, I have here, let me do
that. Are you going to equalize them?
I don't know. That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Know what you want to do.
If I have a copper plate on this side, and I have a zinc plate on this side, and you know they're all in parallel, I don't care about that because they're giving energy throughout the whole system. You know what I'm saying? That part doesn't matter. I'm in salt, I'm in different metals, and now I'm ready to add caustic, okay?
Yes.
To balance each one of my units so that it's a livable system. I don't use electricity. I use air. I use an air pump for each unit,
yeah, which
oxidizes each one of them. And from the salt and the plates that I'm using, I want to keep that in a balanced environment, meaning that I want to make it a livable system. And I couldn't even tell you what I did with the salt. I started out because Caroline told us to put our feet in the salt to move the energy and all that. But anyway, the salt is the most important part between the two parallels. So what I'm asking you is, if I had two plain plates, right, like he just drew there, a plain zinc plate, a plain copper plate.
And so not nano.
No nano.
I understand.
Okay. a zinc plate, a copper plate in salt solution. And I use a nice Himalayan salt, okay? I let the water steep. I let the water, all the chemicals come out. It's a nice Himalayan with 83 minerals in it. Now I want to add caustic in that water, this, because I don't know what the balance, once I the water that I've used, the place that I've put in, I don't have the money to buy a digital pH balance, pH meter yet.
There is a paper, test paper, pH test paper, for instance.
But my hypothesis, this is my thinking, but my affordability isn't there yet.
You can buy from Banggood.com. They ship.
I know all that stuff.
$9 for this.
I've been in it with you as long as you've been in it. So you need a digital meter. I need to know the numbers in order to start. So my thought is, once we have that salt solution, these two plain plates, a zinc and a copper, in the salt solution with all the natural minerals in the water. Now we take the reading. Now we add the caustic in the water. After we take in the reading from everything, before we add the caustic, there's no nano coating done anywhere.
Okay,
it's just two plates. And
so what you do here, if you put two plates of different metals, for instance, copper and zinc.
Well, I live in Michigan because I know what salt will do to two metal plates. It'll start degenerating or start.
Yeah, so actually you will have here a generator, like a volta element. It's a basic volta element. And you have to know that you have no sodium chloride. Once you dissolve it, you have sodium ion. You have chlorine ion, you have hydrogen again in ions, you have more exactly, you have hydrogen and OH ion. You see, so you will have such a combinations. You will have a sodium ion, again OH ion, if you add this to it. So if you have chlorine in that water, the pH will go acid. If you add the sodium hydroxide, that makes it more alkaline. So by changing the ratio of sodium chloride and sodium hydroxide, you can balance the pH somewhere.
Well, I know how to do that now.
From here to here in some range.
Yes. Isn't that worse? We have
but to. What's the purpose? What's the purpose of the experiment? I understand it's interesting, but what's the purpose of it?
Well, the purpose is that once I start making a system again, I need to have it in balance, a balance of for me. Every person has the balance of, do we want a communication system? Do we want a space system? Do we want a health system? And that'll all start with the pH and the balance that we have been in, or we were created in. And that's what I'm trying to figure out is, once we introduce metals into the creation, that's where we're going to move forward in our shielding, in our health systems, in our
How you want to do a shielding and health system without using nanomaterials, without creating gas in the nanostate materials, just with some metals in the waters?
Mr. Kesh already told us that if we make our minds expand in carbon is the energetic package, CHO or CH, if that's an energy package that can hold and give. he just gave he gave us something that we could use, meaning that he used to make systems for people using hot glue guns.
Yes, what he told about the hot glue guns was about the health cocks, which he made since many years successfully. And there he used a small magnet, be it a hollow magnet or a flat magnet, and where he applied here some GANs. And this was the importance of the GANs and the GANs energy. And he used additionally here a hot glue. And that hot glue containing carbon and hydrogen that also added to the entire formula.
Yeah, but we're a lot faster thinkers than that.
Don't just stick on the that glue. So no, it's no. More complex. A health cup is a more way no. More complex thing.
My mind goes a lot faster than that because once we know that we've tapped into a situation that we can change the molecular situation like he did with the hot glue that's carbon based that takes it up to 120 degrees, there's a lot more we can do that holds and gives. That's an energy package that we can use. You know,
the whole magic comes due to the nanomaterials and due to the GANs and due to the plasma fields.
Yes.
And that hot glue, which is in a matter state, it just changes the condition slightly. So it acts as a part of the condition. So many times Mr. Cash told about conditions and conditions. Yes. And conditions are many. It's the location, it's the fields outside, it's the temperature, it's the material used, it's the distances, the masses.
You know what? I love you so much because you grind at it so hard. And I'm just a poor painter from Michigan, Detroit, Michigan. And I've watched a lot of people and you put a lot of thought processes into it. And I appreciate everything you've done.
And you're welcome.
We're working together as one. And I'm so happy. I was so scared in the beginning. I had an awakening that scared the heck out of me. And, you know, guys like you that just keep plugging along, you, Lee, and everybody else. I just want to say thank you. We're getting close to the end. You know what I'm saying?
Ask you a question about what you were talking about before, if I can? You were saying you can separate zinc from the CO2 by rinsing it over and over again with salt water. Is that correct? Oh.
To the question, Shandor.
I'd be glad to see more and more people thinking of these processes in terms of plasma. We all learned the chemistry in the school. We all learned physics as well. We know so many phenomena explained by the traditional science, which is mainly an observation of the effect. And my wish is to have people to understand those processes in terms of plasma, what happens there. In terms of plasma, why two magnets are repelling each other or pulling one to the other, or why if we add the nano-coated plate into a salt water, why it does something, and so on. So to put questions and to think them in terms of plasma. For instance, just one simple thing. You see, I put again some GANs kits This is copper with copper. This is copper, nano-copper with iron. You see no gas bubbles. Meanwhile, it's the same water like it's in this one. And you see this is full of bubbles. This is the CO2 kit. What are those bubbles? And why are on the wall of the container? What do you think? Look, some are growing bigger. And later they end here in a gas state in the bottom.
Sandor,
have you ever thought about why these bubbles are coming up in every CO2 kit? What are those bubbles made of? Are those oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, or CO2? Think about why those are there and why they stick to that CH bond, to that plastic.
I know why.
Yes, please.
I nano-coated my plastic.
Yes, sure.
Yeah.
It's a nano-coated plastic.
Sandor, we love you. There's 13 people out of 7 billion of us.
Oh, as I told on Friday to the Romanian group and yesterday evening to the...
This is absolutely a wonderful experience.
I just repeated what Mr. Cash taught us a long time ago, and which I used to say at the start of a new course, that we are over 7 billion, maybe 7.2 billion people on Earth. And about this big number, maybe 80% of people will understand about the matter state, about solid, liquid, and gases, and how these states of matter work. And maybe 5% will understand about the nanostate, which is a different state of matter. Although it looks like solid, it's not like the solid. And maybe 1% or 2% will understand about gas in nanostate. And maybe 1% will understand about plasma. And maybe 1% of that 1%, so 0.001% of the total humans, about 72 millions, will understand about how to manipulate plasma. It's a huge number, is it so? Oh, sorry, about the plasma will understand 72 millions, and 720,000 will understand how to manipulate plasma. And these are just statistics. And those will be the future's builders of spaceship. Those who will understand how to use, how to handle, how to manipulate plasma. But from history and statistics, we know that such a pioneers who will do the first vehicles, first spaceships, hopefully 1 out of 5 will be able to make it, to bring it to success and to not get lost somewhere in the space. And maybe those will be the survivors who will return and not the survivors who will be lost somewhere else. So what we can expect about 140, 150,000 people on this planet Earth, those to be in the future, the successful returning spaceship makers. So these are the numbers. We can't do anything about that. So welcome in the group of a few who are interested to learn about these subjects, because we are not too many, you see. We do all the efforts to make people to understand, but we can only inspire for them to gather their knowledge. We cannot give the knowledge like giving a pill, because knowledge, it's gathered by personal experience. We can give a little understandings. We can give a little inspiration for them to get an enlightenment. And then once being enlightened, they know what to do, and by their doing, they will gather the experience, and the collection of experience will become knowledge. That was my point. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sandor. That was excellent. Just the pep talk we needed to hear, I think.
Sorry for I'm so emotional speaking. So it seems I'm recovering from my heart incident, which I had about 1 month ago.
Oh, you did? I didn't hear about that.
Oh. I returned from Dubai, so you know, before Dubai I didn't sleep a couple of nights when it was a huge temperature change.
Mm-hmm.
Over here was 15 centigrades and there was 35 centigrades. Mm-hmm. So the first night I was able to go to bed to 3 o'clock and a friend called me by 4 o'clock. Oh, are you okay? Yes, thank you. You woke me up. I wasn't able to sleep again. Next night, 3 hours. And we had another night when we had a long meeting from 9 p.m. to 9 a.m. Mm-hmm. After that, I came home. And after that, I said, okay, now it's over all this stress and so on. So let's relax. And the relax brought me to a small heart incident with sharp pain and other things. So luckily, yes. I had nitroglycerin and in spray form, mm-hmm. not in other form, just spray under the tongue and some aspirin. So I handled the situation to not get worse. So I stopped it. So it was such a coronary artery incident or maybe a smaller heart attack and so on. Mm-hmm. So I didn't ask the ambulance to come because I don't like to be put into a hospital. They're not so comfortable conditions. So after 2 weeks, I managed to go to the doctor and so on.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. Thank you, Sandor.
You're welcome. And thank you for your patience, because now I release too much talking.
No.
I'm letting you talk more.
We appreciate you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thanks for your input.
We do love you, Sandor. Absolutely. And, everybody loves each other here when it comes right down to it. That's what it's all about. And if you didn't have that attitude, you probably wouldn't be here. So that's just the way it works out.
Time is very light, and maybe next week I will suggest some topics on how to make visible or how to measure these magnetic plasmatic fields.
Good one.
Maybe we have a hope with some little thinking and about the research finding of proper materials. Just as a short thing, maybe you have heard about the ferrocell as an invention.
The which? Pardon me?
Ferrocells. It's like a lens. It's made of two round pieces of glass with the ends sealed, and in between there is a liquid with a nano material which is like a ferrofluid. Mm-hmm. There are some magnetical nanoparticles, and this is lit by some LEDs in a frame. You have to use it in a dark room, mm-hmm. but it makes some beautiful visual apparition of the fields. How about instead of a ferrofluid, something which reacts magnetically to the fields of the magnetism for the iron? How do I use some GANS materials or mixtures of GANS?
Yes, the
which
copper.
Under the light would show some shining up.
Mm-hmm. And then maybe an alteration with fields, how the light plays. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So definitely these plasmatic GANS forces have an effect over the position of the small GANS particles. We have seen it so many times. For instance, Zoltán Szabó from Hungary, once he moved, started a new plasma reactor, a Maghreb reactor, and then he had all the GANS of one of his CO2 kits moving on one side of the walls. Climbing up the wall.
Mm-hmm.
We can do this in a liquid, in an emulsion between two transparent glass plates, and giving a lighting around with LED to make those to shine. In that case, maybe we have something to visualize some field forces of other strength than the strength of the iron, but of the strength of CO2 and so on.
Yeah, similar to what I was showing before with the light that can be put on a rotating GANS arrangement. You can see the layering much easier with the lighting. Okay, well, I need to wrap things up here fairly quickly. Anybody else who would like to make a comment? We're still trying to get Libby to say something. Hint.
Okay, I'm here.
I'm sorry, Libby.
Oh, that's okay. It's okay. I'm happy that I actually woke up.
in time. I missed most of the first hour, and I don't have any much projects. I love what you're doing here, Rick. This lamp with the vector thing, not lamp, the ball. All I have to say is what everybody else is saying. I'm so grateful you have this group, Rick, and I love everybody here. And Mark, I'm sorry I cut you off about Sylvester, but I figured you didn't know. And I just love everybody. I'll get back to my experiments. I am still cleaning out the pond, but the pollen from all the trees got into the pond. And there's no running water in the pond, so it's quite the experiment I'm working on. It's a beautiful pond. I actually did land in another piece of paradise. What are those beautiful bubbles in there, Rick?
Well, there's sparkles in there. You can see the little pieces. They're gold sparkles.
Oh, cool.
And some of them, I was pointing out just now with my finger, some of them are floating on the surface of the water. Some of them have gone right down to the bottom. And then when they're rotated, of course, they start forming a ring. And it's interesting where the ring forms, not in the middle, but just below the middle, because the particles are pulled by gravity below the center line of this particular globe, at least until it gets going faster, which then brings it up a little higher into the middle more. But right now,
how many RPMs?
Oh, there, that's only doing probably a couple hundred RPMs or something there now. But I can take.
Below the
equator.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's right. And as it's revved up, it tends to see. Now it's going a little faster, and it pulls it up toward the middle. Mm. And there's a Gans ring that's starting to form. And the water becomes more clear after you rotate it for a bit. Then it starts to completely clarify in the middle, and all of the Gans or any particles are jammed to the sides of the sphere. We're just experimenting with different speeds, and this apparatus is fun. I'm going to bring it back out and do some more experiments with it. I can rotate the whole thing 360 degrees, so I can turn this right side up or upside down or sideways or any which way I want to while it's running. And I can also access it with a vacuum pump to vacuum it out while it's running, or add or subtract gases or liquids from it. So it's quite a versatile system, and it's just a matter of which one of billions of experiments would you like to do today. You have to focus on only one at a time. That's one of the problems of our human condition. We can't do, and the problem of time, we can't do everything all at once. That's why time exists, so we can only do one thing at a time. So
I disagree.
We can do everything all at once?
I think time is on our side.
I agree there. Time has been defined by someone once as the unique subjective. So it doesn't actually exist except in our own minds.
Are we subjected to 90 years or 800 years?
Or 8 billion years. Hmm.
Thank you, my friend. You will be the first one that I come to pick up with on my spaceship.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Please stand in line.
Let's all go together, huh?
That sounded like Army.
We're working hard together.
Speaking of spaceship, how's yours coming along, Armin? Have you gotten any interesting results lately that you can reveal to us, or is it all still top secret in your life?
No. I can show you a few GANs making techniques that you can make your own GANs.
Mm-hmm. Yay!
Okay, sure.
Finally, somebody with authority.
We all have authority. That's the secret.
All of us.
That's the That's the new secret, is we all have authority. Yeah, we do. It's definitely, I would listen to Armin before I listen to myself any day.
I'm sorry, I got to unmute here. I should, I'm bad.
You see this?
Let me stop the share here first, and let's get yours spotlighted and pull this down and get this up. And yes, there we see it. Okay, what do you have here now?
It's gold GANs.
It's, pardon me, what GANs? Gold GANs?
Gold.
Oh my God. Cool. Oh my gosh.
This is...
good gosh.
This is silver. If you see.
Yes.
It's what again? Pardon me?
Silver.
Could you just tell us the process in which you, the steps in which you went to get that?
The process is very simple, actually. The way you create your CO2 boxes. You set it up the way that you have pure material. Actually, if you don't have a pure gold, just consider what kind of mixture you have. When they make 14 karat gold, some of the jewelers, they mixing with nickel. It's a white gold. It's nickel and silver. Silver they're making, and what else they have?
Uranium.
No.
Uranium, rhodium.
No. Beryllium, yes, beryllium. And if it's white, but if it's yellow gold, they add actually. Hello?
Oh, sorry, my neighbors are doing this all the week.
If you have a 14 carat, just consider what kind of alloy your gold mixture have, so you consider that you're still gonna carry that GANs inside your GANs material. But this is the one I showed it to you. It's 14 carat, so white 14 carat white gold. So I know that it has some zinc and has some silver. It's 10% silver, 12% zinc, and I think beryllium or nickel. It depends what kind of mixture they done. So you consider that too.
And could you explain the process again? Do you use it as an electrode in the, or do you put it in with the GANs when you make the CO2?
Two ways you can produce it. Yes, if you put it in electrode, and run a little bit higher voltage, one of your plates is going to become nano. It's going to become black after an hour or so. What I do, I right away, if my mixture, my actually medium is salt only, after that, when I finish it, my production, I just add NaOH, a little bit drops of NaOH. And right away, you create a puffy, GANs out of it. It's in a second, instant.
So you take,
you use the,
you have a salt, I'm sorry, Mario, go ahead.
If you have a salt water, okay, when you produce your GANs, add a little bit NaOH right away, it will create white, puffy white GANs.
But you're just using two non-nano coated plates of what? Two both gold or one copper?
Both
one
gold. No, both gold.
Both gold.
Oh, both gold.
You create one nano and one stays, because if you connect it with plus and minus, whatever your plus, it will stay whitish.
Right.
Or the minus, it will create a black dark color.
So you take the, you have a salt solution, and then you put gold and gold, and then you add the caustic solution in it to strip the gold into.
You're already stripping the gold into. You already have your GAN structure in it. But when you add little bit NaOH in the Na, actually salt solution, it's right away brings to puffy condition.
But
so
we
condition in the water right away.
There's already gold GANs in that solution of salt.
Correct.
Gold nano, maybe, is that what it
is? No, it's not gold, nano. It is nano, but it's not like puffy. But no. The minute you introduce, see this?
Can't see.
I can't.
Okay, there we go. Me spotlight.
Yes.
If you see it.
Yes.
How puffy it is.
Armin, how do you now coat the gold? You said you have two gold plates, one now coated, one not. And the gold is not very easy to nanocoat.
Yeah.
He said it nanocoats itself.
Doesn't nanocoat it.
For me here.
The caustic solution strips the nanocoat.
Look how nano it is.
It just happens after time.
Wow,
how much?
Gorgeous.
How much power do you put in?
If you measure it by, you know, ohms, on 20 ohms, 2 ohms, actually, it's perfect nano.
Does the nano coating start once you introduce the caustic solution in the salt water?
Actually, I do first caustic solution, then I do salt solution.
And then Armin, Armin, this is Sylvester. What I feel from the questions we hear is the full process.
I understand what the question is, Sylvester.
Okay, the full process.
So we had two gold plates.
This one is nano silver, pure silver. 9999.
Right.
Look.
Yes. Did you nano coat that, or did the caustic solution?
No, when you put in a caustic solution in a very, let's say, low, running your amperage 0.5 or less of that, and when you leave it a little bit time, it will create this nano layer.
What kind of voltage are you talking about? Like a volt and a half or 2 volts or something?
And by amperage, it's in half an amp.
No, in voltage, like a half a volt? A volt?
Yeah, well, no. Let's say 2 volts.
Okay. 2 volts. Yeah.
So 2 volts in salt solution with that.
Not in salt, in caustic solution.
No, solution.
Yeah, there's some confusion there whether to start in the caustic or in the salt solution.
No, you start in the caustic to create the nano, then you go to the salt, then you can add a little bit in NaOH, and you create a, you know, GANs of gold. Actually, you already create GANs of gold when it's in any solution, even if it's in a caustic solution.
So, Armin, in conclusion, for these difficult metals, you use for nano-coating the electric method in a caustic solution.
Yes.
So, same like in electrochemical etching, by applying current on them
in the caustic.
That removes the top layer of atoms, which a part of them will restructure on the top as a nano layer.
Yeah.
There's a short description.
But you have to use two plates. So you have to use two pieces of gold.
Correct.
Or one piece of gold and the other side.
No. Then you introduce different material. If you want to have a purity, it has to be pure.
That's best.
Almond. So if we just took a salt solution and put two pieces of gold and then started adding the caustic in that water.
No, after you run it an hour or two, then you see it's going to become a little bit darker and white, kind of, you know, like mist inside.
Yes. It starts to make the puffy water or the puffy cloud on the bottom.
Yeah.
So
not bottom, in that upper atmosphere of the, let's say,
it's starting to make the reaction.
Yes.
So I'm asking you, we have two plain plates, no nano coating.
No nano coating.
Do we connect the two plates?
No.
It's just two plain plates.
One negative, one positive.
In the salt condition.
Yeah, you can nano coat any material, but you have to use
zinc plate. I can nano coat a zinc plate with caustic.
No, zinc. You nano coat only the vapor. You don't put in a NaOH because it will dissolve.
Right. Okay. It'll dissolve.
Actually, it releases oxygen, so it releases the material.
Same thing
you do when you nano coat your plates, let's say copper plates. Did you ever consider to collect the residual from the caustic?
Say that one more time. Let me get that one more time.
One minute.
Meanwhile, I have drawn here what Armand used to do. In a plastic container, there is a solution of distilled water in caustic, and he passes currents through two electrodes.
This is when you do just a nano coating, and it's always residual you can collect from your plastic boxes, you know. And this residual, a minute you introduce, it's everything considered in here. It says CO2. It says copper, it says zinc, whatever was in a container, now you have a gas of it. It's a rapid release of gas.
Is the container that has the carbon, you know, the plastic container, is that the package that holds the energy?
Yeah, I used to always, when I nano coat, I always used to put a piece of,
plastic,
hot glue.
See, that's what I'm getting to. So let me ask you, would I want to make my containers to make GANS now? And I'm asking myself, because Mr. Cash just said that if you take plastic.
No. This is for different. This is for rapid release of hydrogen into your nano material.
Yes, and I'm trying to accelerate my thought process into the GANS process, or how I'm going to make it. So the containers that I'm going to make the GANS in, I want to take that to another level. And plastic jugs, and I want to heat them up to 160 degrees, the plastic containers, so that they are the giving and receiving package that he said, like the hot GANS or the hot glue that holds.
Even the plastic you have already, it's already releasing hydrogen.
Right, but what he said, if you heat that plastic up to a certain point, a certain temperature, like he said, it's a small secret, but that not
and
a lot
can of- I ask you a question? If you think you release atoms from copper, why you don't think that you're going to release it from carbon structure?
Well, I got rid of all the copper out of it.
No, I'm not saying. I'm just saying when you nano coat your material, correct? The minute you introduce it into the caustic, it's a hit difference that it releases molecular structure to atomic structure.
Yes.
Okay, and in that moment, when even after when you when it's all cooked, all the material is cooked, I put some, you know, like salt. You know, you put some.
Use honey. I used the honey because it was.
You can use sugar. Direct sugar.
But sugar is sometimes processed. So I thought that the bee that made the honey.
No. Sugar is directly CH bond.
Okay.
So if bee puke.
Yeah. You know, we use to, you know, a mix with salt. We used to, some sugar with it too. And yes. Always your GANs, copper GANs, mostly become blue. Even you run a low current, but it releases so much hydrogen. So you have energized GANs in your hands, actually.
So the sugar and the sugar and the carbon from the plastic is a feeder, right?
It is feeder.
It's feeder. Okay.
You release the hydrogen, so it fits the nanomaterial when you create those. So it's an environment; it carries that field. So you are your nano coating. It's already going to have whatever you put in your container. If you have zinc, piece of zinc. If you have iron. Consider all of it what's in the environment of your, you know, box.
Well, including your box. I'm working with vinyl tubes.
Vinyl tubes.
You know, the tubing that you can buy from a hardware store, the PVC tubes, or, you know, all these.
Those kind of things.
Pardon me?
It's simple. You know, don't complicate yourself that you've been lost in the knowledge, you know.
Right, exactly.
You understand what exactly, you know, what's happening in your container, then you will have full visualization what kind of GANs you're going to have it in there, or what kind of nanomaterial, what energy you pass it through the nanomaterial. Whatever it's in environment is going to be in your nanomaterial. So you have a zinc, you already have a zinc in that copper layers, you know.
So whatever we work with, we move from a material state to a plasma state to a GANs.
Because every material, whatever you introduce, it's going to become a plasmatic level and it's going to pass it through the nanomaterial.
So we should.
Armin, can I ask you? I just want to make sure I have something clear on the nano coating process of the gold and the silver. Mm-hmm. Are you saying you used two plates, not nano-coated, of gold in salt water solution? You connected them to a wire with a positive and negative, ran a charge of 0.5 amps.
A little bit higher. When you want to create that nano-layer, you're creating nano-layer, but it's not high enough to release it. I understand.
Well, you mean if I'm going to nano-coat it like that way, I won't get the nano-layers?
Which way you're going to nanocoat?
With just the salt water, not the caustic. Is that what you were saying initially to nanocoat the gold or silver?
Actually, in a caustic, if you have, you can create differently too. You can have your material and you could put, you know, put a lot of caustic on it and leave it. And put little bit water on it and leave it. Close your container, leave it as is.
So a cold caustic on gold will work.
It's not cold caustic, a little bit hot water even, you know, and leave it in the caustic. So it's not solution, it's like a paste, you know. Don't put too much water, just put a little bit to make it moist, you know, to start the process more rapid. But it takes a little bit longer time.
Okay, and like a plastic bag would be okay like that?
Doesn't matter where you put.
Yeah. Okay.
Keep it in a close container so the environment don't change. So then you're gonna have a start to create a nano layer on your metal. Actually,
but
when they pour, it's very hard to do it. But It's not hard, actually.
You mean to make the paste, like to get it pasty on the gold or whatever?
It's moist, huh? It takes the moist and it starts the process.
Okay. So what you're saying, Armis, is once we see the paste, then if we add water to it, that becomes the plasma water to the paste?
You don't do that. You just leave it in it. And if, you know, 1 week or time, you know, it will become black.
Right.
You take that nanomaterial, whatever metal you put it there, then you put it in the salt water and create your gas.
Oh, okay.
Don't put it to a high current that you release the nanomaterial.
I don't use any current at all. I use water, air.
I have a bar. I have a plastic box which every small piece of metal, doesn't matter what it is, you know, copper,
titanium, zinc, titanium,
whatever. What I did, I had a lot of leftovers, and I put it in that container, added NaOH, water, a little bit salt, and leave it like 2, 3, 4 months.
Right.
4 months, it created so much gas, you cannot even imagine.
On the bottom.
On the bottom. Here, I can show it to you.
Hey, man, this is Dave. I've been away for a while, but Mr. Cash said the NOH kind of breaks up the gold or whatever, and then you can better make it into nanoparticles.
Yeah.
Oh, that's pretty.
Is that gold, Gans?
No, it's mixture, but it's naturally produced.
No electric.
No electric, and in 3-4 months, and it's produced a lot. Well, this is half of it, actually.
In space, we're never going to have electricity, so we might as well figure out how to do it before that.
In space, you can have everything what you want.
You can use a dental cap and probably get some very pure gold.
So,
Rick,
hello. We have to sort of bring things to a close here, I think, guys.
Okay. I'm so sorry that I've done all this. I so look forward to this day, and I'm so happy. And there's not many of us that the wisdom of everybody is. I can't even explain how happy my heart feels to everybody. And I know you got to go to bed because tomorrow's.
Well,
we love you too, Mark.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, we have to sort of end things because the online teaching is starting, and so I don't want to interfere with that.
Okay, guys.
Thanks a lot, Armin. I appreciate your
input. Thank you, Armin.
As usual.
Hey, Rick, this is Dave. Are you going to stay over at Allie's anymore?
Sorry, there's a bad echo happening. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I saw your video over at Allie's. Is there a better one without all the...
from Armin there.
Misses in it?
Pardon me? From what? Sorry?
Your video when you were over at Allie's. Mm-hmm. And I listened to it, and it was all cut up. Is there a better recording?
Not that I know of. There may be. I don't. I'm not sure about that one. It was hard getting the broadcast proper. Yeah, it was very hard to hear.
I know he's got a low bandwidth connection there. I think that was the problem. I thought.
Yep, that's right. So that happens sometimes. You have to deal with it. And I don't think there's anything.
Rick, this is Sylvester. I hope I'm not saying something secret, but happy birthday.
Well, it's not until tomorrow, but...
I'm living in the future. For me, it's already ringing the bell.
I happen to have a birthday, and so does Vince, on the same day as the next workshop, Thursday.
And mine is June 3rd.
Oh, is that right, eh? Well, there you go. So, yeah. It'll be interesting to have a birthday on the 116th Knowledge Seekers Workshop. I think that's pretty cool. So we'll see. Okay, thank you everybody for participating. It was a pretty hot session today. Lots of things came up. We even got some emotions going there for a bit and all that. And it was good interrelating and lots of information. And I'm thankful there's lots of things I picked up tonight.
I can't wait till the next one. Things have really been hopping here. I've got up to date with everything. And so
yep, talk to you. You can look at the... The video will be on the top 40, in the live stream as usual. I'm trying to get them actually put up on the website too. I've started doing that with the Plasma Reactor Group beyond the Keshe Foundation YouTube site.
Okay. The force field thing is really exciting.
Pardon me?
The force field thing that Moran brought up.
I can't get into other stuff, other topics right now because we have to end it. But for next time we can certainly bring up all that kind of thing.
Happy birthday, Rick.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Rick. I'm sorry for hogging the time.
You don't have to be sorry at all, Mark. I'm glad you're coming out of the closet with all your stuff, and it seems like you're going full speed ahead. So this is the place to get the information, anything you need to know. This is why we're here, basically, is to help each other in the Keshe Plasma Reactor Group. It's to show and tell and help out. So thank you, everybody, for helping out that way.
Everybody feels like friends, and you're a friend, and you feel... make me feel like I want to do it because you're a good person and you project so much goodness. You know, the teachings of Mr. Keshe are international for all the souls to absorb, but this little group here, and I apologize to everybody that I stepped on their toes, but you know what, We're innovators here, and you have little creations in all of us, and we should never take up more than 10 or 15 minutes of our time because everybody has input. And
we have to wish that Rick doesn't get burned out of his house there.
Yes.
Boy, that was really terrible.
What are you talking about, burned out of my house?
I'm going to send you...
Wait a minute. What are you talking about, burned out of my house? What the hell are you talking about?
The Alberta fires.
Oh, no, that's nothing to do with me. Sorry.
Well, you're pretty close to there.
Jesus, no, it's thousands of kilometers away, thanks. I have nothing to do with that. Don't freak me out about being burned out of my house. I don't need to hear that at the end of the broadcast. Brother. Thank you very much. Okay, so anyways, I'd just like to say... we probably could have heard from maybe P and some of the others there. Maybe Guy had something to show as well. I'm not sure. Yeah. Anyway, we do have to end things here because I don't want to interfere with the online teaching that's going on. That's the main thing. So I'm going to stop the live stream. Mm-hmm.